Dear students, we were discussing about income tax. In my previous class, what we have covered? We have covered the meaning of direct tax, meaning of indirect tax, meaning of income tax, and the five sources of income. And after that, we have discussed who is assessing, who is person. Okay, so till this portion we have completed the syllabus related to income tax. In today's class, we are supposed to discuss some other terms relating to income tax. Okay, up to assessee and person we have already completed the discussion. In today's class, we are going to discuss some other terms of income tax. So these are the most important terms. Okay, so it will be the case of previous class, or it will be the case of today's class. Three single point I'm discussing with you. It's the most important points. Okay, so let me begin with the assessment here. So here, what is assessment here? Assessment here, as per income tax, what is assessment here? The quite simple meaning, assessment here is the duration of 12 months. It is a duration of 12 months which begins on 1st of April and which ends on 31st March. Okay, in short, what we need to say, assessment here is a duration of 12 years in which presently we are. In which presently we are. The most important point you have to remember is that assessment year begins on 1st April. Okay, so 1st April and ends on 31st March. Okay, see, for example, 1/4/2020. Already it has been completed. Okay, we have passed this date. Okay, already we are in the month of October. So therefore we have crossed this date. And 1/4/2020. This is the 1st April. Okay, so assessment year begins on 1st of April. So this is the beginning date. And after this, which 31st March will come?
31st March 2024.
Still it has not come. Already we have passed this. It has to come yet. So in between we are in right now. Okay. So therefore, assessment year is nothing but it is a year in which we are presently in, and which begins on 1st of April and which ends on 31st March. Okay. So therefore, this is the assessment year. Okay. So after stating assessment year, previous year. Meaning of previous year. This is also most important. So therefore, let us understand previous year. So previous year is also a duration of 12 months. It also begins on 1st of April and ends on 31st March. But the difference between previous year and assessment year. Okay, so quite simple, assessment year. So before this, whatever the financial year is there, that is called as previous year. For example, so this is our present assessment year. So right behind this, which year was? So here 1/4/2019. So exactly behind, and then the next 31st March 2020. 31st March 2020. This is also duration of 12 months. This is also duration of 12 months. So here, why we need to study assessment year and previous year? It's quite simple. In the assessment year, the year in which we are, in that year, we will calculate the taxable income of assessees. Of which year? Of previous year. Very simple. The income of assessee of previous year will be calculated for the purpose of imposing tax liability in the assessment year. Okay, so therefore they are interrelated. So the income of previous year will be calculated in the year of year. So in the assessment year itself, we are supposed to impose tax liability on the assessees. So this is about assessment year and previous year. Okay, so if there is any confusion regarding understanding these two, so watch this video repeatedly. Very simply you will understand. Okay, so after that, next one is assessment. Here, what is assessment? Assessees are supposed to pay income tax. So before paying income tax, they have to calculate what is their tax liability. Okay, so therefore, calculating the tax liability itself is called as assessment year. You should not have any confusion. Okay, so assessee has to pay income tax. So before paying income tax, he has to calculate is a tax liability, and the procedure of calculating tax liability itself is called as assessment. Okay, so after this, next one is gross total income. After that, total income. So first, let us understand what is gross total income. Assessees, they earn income in five sources. Source number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So in my previous class, I have discussed these five sources. Okay, for example, an assessee is there who has earned salary of rupees 1 lakh in a year, and he has let out his house property. Of that house property, has received income of rupees 60,000. Okay, so the next third, business and profession, is not carrying on any business or is not a professional person, so there is no income. Income from capital gains. Capital gains nothing but income arising out of transfer of properties. Okay, so in previous year, what he has done? He has sold a house property, and there he has earned income of rupees 1 lakh. And the next is income from other sources. Income from other sources, what is the meaning of income from other sources? An income which is not salary, house property, business and profession, and capital gain, that is called as income from other sources. So he may be, let us take example, he has earned interest of rupees 10,000 by depositing amount into bank. This is what he has earned. Okay, so from these four sources. Okay, therefore, the total income of these four sources itself is called as gross total income. Okay, for calculating income from salary, a particular mechanism is there. For house property, for business and profession, capital gains, for income from other sources. Okay, I have just given examples. Okay, so to write down these values, particular mechanism is there, we need to follow that. After following that, we will calculate the incomes, and so calculated incomes of all the sources, they are called as gross total income. This is the meaning of gross total income. So for example, 60, 260, 270,000. This is called as gross total income. And then next one is total income. So here, what is total income? So to understand what is total income, so already we have understood what is the meaning of gross total income. To this gross total income, deductions are available. Some deductions are available. What are those deductions? In the semester number 5, in the semester number 6, you will come to know. Right now, you just have to keep in your mind, some deductions are available. What are those deductions? Those deductions are under section 80C to 80U. Deductions under section 80C to 80U. This much of deductions are available for every assessee. Okay, so these deductions are deducted from gross total income. Very simple. Deduction 80C to 80U. Almost 20-25 deductions are there from these sections. Okay, these deductions are deducted from gross total income. So after deducting these deductions into gross total income, whatever the income is left, that is treated as a total income. For example, 270,000 is there. We have calculated deductions under section 80C to 80U. It has come to this 20,000 deduction. So what is the balance? 270,000 minus deduction of 20,000. The remaining amount, 250,000. This 250,000 is called as total income. So suppose total income. And the next one, casual incomes. Casual incomes, quite simple meaning. Unexpected incomes are treated as casual incomes. Unexpected incomes. For example, I have taken a lottery and I have won prize of rupees 1 lakh. So was there any certainty that I would have got lottery income of rupees 1 lakh? No. It was uncertain income. So such uncertain incomes are called as casual incomes. So lottery is the example, and horse race betting. I have bet rupees 10,000 in horse race. I have won rupees 20,000 from horse race. It was unexpected totally. So therefore, such unexpected incomes are called as casual incomes. And then next, agricultural income. So agricultural income. Why do you want to understand agricultural income? Because whatever the income we earn from the agricultural land, on that income we don't need to pay any income tax. We don't need to pay any income tax. So therefore, agricultural income, it is exempted from tax. We don't need to pay income tax. Okay. So here, what is agricultural income? So agricultural income is nothing but it is an income arising out of agricultural activities. That may be sowing seeds. That may be domesticating the cattle. So such incomes are there relating to agriculture. So therefore, agricultural income, whatever the income we receive, that is exempted from tax. But there is a particular condition. That condition is to be fulfilled. That basic condition is that the agricultural income we receive, that agricultural land must be situated in India. Then only it is exempted from tax. If it is not situated in India, if it is situated in America, England, or somewhere else, so on such agricultural income we have to pay income tax. But if agricultural land is situated in India, whatever the amount, irrespective of any salary, whatever the income we receive, that entire amount is exempted from tax. So it is about agricultural income. And the next one, permanent account number, PAN. So most of you are holding your PAN cards. So here, what is PAN card? Permanent account number. So permanent account number, it is nothing but it is a code number provided by the income tax authority. Very simple. Okay, if you are asked the question that what is a PAN, what is PAN, then your simple answer must be PAN is a code. A permanent account number is a code given by the income tax authorities. So that's it. So about the permanent account number, so these are the important terms. In this entire year, they will be coming before you often. So therefore, if any doubts, if you have any doubts about these terms, so you can send your